Hey guys, this is Paul Natone of Radio Carbon Art Productions, and I've produced all 26 of the how-to RC soaring videos on the radiocarbonart.com website. So please go to my site, check out my videos if you're a beginner, intermediate, or even advanced pilot. I have a lot of videos which are going to help you build airplanes properly, tune them, and fly them better. So in today's video, we're going to take a look at an old Radian here. And what we're going to do is we're going to do a servo swap to get the servos to work better in the servo bay. And actually, I think the servos are worn out on this particular plane. This plane might look familiar. I did a tune-up video on this Radian about 5 or 6 years ago when the first ones came out, because people were having problems with the airplanes pulling up too much under power. They're looping around their heads under power. They wouldn't trim correctly. They just didn't fly very well. You know, flew more like a power plane than a sailplane. So definitely check out that video if you haven't seen it already. It's got over 100,000 views. It's the most popular video on my YouTube channel. I had no idea it would be so popular. So this airplane's been in storage for 3 years. Haven't really flown it much. Has a lot of miles on it, a lot of crashes. A lot of people have flown this plane and biffed it. So it may have some structural issues. I just remember the last time I flew it, it had a condition called double neutral. And what that is, double neutral can be on any surface, but in this particular plane, it was the elevator system. So the plane's flying along, you push a little bit of down elevator, but the elevator would stick and not return back to center. So the airplane would just slowly dive down with that new trim. That's where the elevator's stuck. You pull a little back stick, the plane will rise up, but it won't hold because it sticks in more in the up position because it doesn't go back to true center anymore. And the plane will just want to rise up until you correct it or try to trim it out. So it makes the plane very hard to fly, especially if we're flying at the aft CGs like to fly mine. If the elevator linkage system isn't absolutely perfect and not set up perfectly mechanically, but also to maximize the servo resolution, the airplane's going to be hard to fly. No matter what the decollage is, it'd be hard to fly at aft CGs. So that's one thing I'm going to look at. I did check the tail. All the tail linkages are nice and tight all the way back, but right up at the servo, there's a lot of slop in play. And that's because they put the servos in with these really long servo arms. They basically have the servos backwards from where they should be. You usually want to run the clevis or the L-bend wire, the Z-bend, close to the servo axle as you can, because you want to maximize resolution. We don't need tons of throw, especially on the elevator, but we do need resolution. Those long servo arms also allow the surface to work that servo because it has mechanical leverage over the internal parts of that servo, like the top axle and the little gears, and it'll work back and forth and make the servo wear out a lot quicker. So we're gonna do some surgery, swap the servo positions, and put them the way they should come from the factory. You know, they have 3 generations of these planes out and they haven't changed that really bad servo installation yet. And that's one of the reasons people can't fly these things at the aft CG they kind of need to be at, because there's too much slop and the servos don't have the resolution to really get the accurate trimming and pitch feel that you really need. So we're gonna work on that. Plus we're gonna do a quick inspection of the airplane. Like I say, it's had a lot of miles, quite a few big crashes, some repairs. We're just gonna make sure everything's okay. We're gonna check all the linkages, electrical system, make sure our tape seams are all correct, make sure we don't have any structural issues as well, because flying season's coming up and we're gonna get ready to fly this old thing. I'm gonna see if I get my son interested in flying it again. He got pretty good at it, but he sort of got bored and he hasn't flown it for quite a while. So we're gonna get that thing ready for spring flying. Let's start in and let's work on those servos and do an inspection. This free tutorial on improving the Radian glider is brought to you by Radio Carbon Art, makers of the world's best instructional videos covering all aspects of the sport of RC soaring. Use the coupon code RADIAN15 at the radiocarbonart.com website to get 15% off your digital download or DVD order. All cards and PayPal accepted. Now I do want to take a close look at the wings here. This is the flaperon connector. That looks in good shape. What I'm basically looking for are any delaminations. I do have high performance packing tape on this wing like I showed in the first video, and the tape has held up remarkably well. Even with the UV, it hasn't yellowed at all and is sticking very well. So I'm basically just going to flex the wings. You can see a little bit of wrinkling there, but I'm looking for some major delams from the tape that would indicate there's some damage to the wing. even out in the tips. It's, you know, it's a little wiggly out here, but definitely stiffer than stock, and tape's really helped. I can see a piece of tape here coming up, so I'll replace that piece. I'll do the same thing on the bottom. I want to put some negative pressure on the wing. So except for a little few tape wrinkles, it looks pretty sound. Now I did do a flapper on upgrade on this plane, so I want to inspect my gap seal. Gap seal is not 100% necessary, but for the full length flaperons, it does, you know, the gap's pretty big on here to get enough deflection on this flaperon. So I just want to make sure that's glued in place, and that all looks pretty good. But I want to check the tape hinge. I've got the packing tape on there, and I used some 3M 77 to stick it down even better. But over time, the tape will lift up from the foam. It looks pretty tight here. Tape goes all the way to the edge where I have the gap seal here, because this end's kind of free floating because of the curve. Looks pretty good. Big stress point is right here at the servo. So you gotta make sure you either have, you know, some SIG easy hinges or something there to keep that from rising. If it's loose and it's pulling away from the foam, as the servo tries to move the surface will just rise up and separate instead of moving the surface. So let me check that. Looks like right here on the end, the tape's pulled up from the foam. So I'm gonna need to pop that piece of tape out, maybe CA it down or put a new piece of tape on there just to get that a little bit tighter. But this wing looks pretty good. For as many miles as this wing has, it's structurally sound as it was new. Pretty cool. Now, just like with the wing, I just want to get everything a full inspection, make sure the cowl is on there. It's come off once and it's been Gorilla glued back on. That looks pretty sound. You also want to check your spinner and make sure all the nut in there is tight. You don't want to throw a prop or anything. Probably the third spinner it's been on here. That looks pretty good. You can see the carbon fiber toe I put on here, which most guys won't be able to do. I think a hollow arrow shaft is really the best way to go, and lay that shaft from the wing saddle, you know, all the way back to the tail is really easier and ultimately stronger for the airplane. You can see the glue is yellowed a little bit. A little sandpaper will take care of that. But the carbon's really stayed stuck to the foam. I'm pretty surprised how durable it's been. And you can see one repair here. That was one of my kids' really hard landings, and he broke the wing saddle area right there with just a piece of plywood in there, spliced in with epoxy on both sides to fix that right up. So that was pretty decent. So I just want to inspect the tail, make sure nothing's broken back here. It's still pretty stiff. So let's go ahead and check the linkages in the back. So in the tail is where most of the wear and tear issues happen here. My first video, I show you how to glue the push rods in. Took out that staple, epoxied everything in so everything's really stiff, and put a little bit of a balsa shim in here so we get a nice fair straight lead into the elevator horn here. And we put the horn on the lowest hole, furthest outside hole in that horn, because we want resolution, not a lot of throw. As CG comes back, we need less and less throw. We want resolution, not throw. Looks pretty good. The linkage is held up nicely. Check the screws. In the video, the first video too, I have a piece of carbon here. We could use a piece of thin plywood or something just to reinforce and tie in this side of the elevator to this side of the elevator. And that all looks nice and super tight. I did put a hinge, one of those easy hinges, between here on the other side, because that's where the main stress point of the elevator is right on this part of the hinge line. And it has a tape hinge. Rest of the elevator going out. And that all looks in good shape. So when I wiggle it here, it's all nice and stiff, but you can see there is some play further down the system, and I'll check that. And that's where the double neutral is coming from. But you just want to make sure the hinge line is nice and tight here. You don't want to have the hinge drift up and down on the hinge line. A lot of times double neutral will come from a loose hinge line somewhere, and especially near where the horn is. That looks pretty good. Let's check out the linkage for the rudder. See it right there. Again, we did the same thing. We have the push rod epoxied down the fuse here, tied in. Didn't need any fairlead balsa because it's a fairly straight run. And we have it moved in two holes. So we're on the second hole, the inboard side of the rudder, because we want a little bit more throw for turning. We're still getting a fair amount of resolution. Once I replace the servo, I think we'll be moving this further out, and we'll still be able to get the same amount of throw, but a lot more resolution, and the rudder should center. You can see how sloppy the rudder is here. I can feel it moving down to the servo end. Nice and tight up here, but there's a lot of slop at the servo end. Now the other thing you want to check for when these planes get older is the molded in hinge. I can tell that this was going to rip, so I've put in pieces of mylar in here to act as a hinge and a little bit of tape too, because that stock factory hinge, I don't think they've changed the mold at all, but it'll eventually wear out and break, and the rudder's just going to want to tear off this way and torque over. A lot of people have the rudders come off in flight because the hinge lets go, nothing to hold the rudder on, and there goes your steering. So that's something you want to check too. As you can see, I kept the 4-degree decalage change in the tail, which matches better for trim to the new CG position, and I haven't changed that. Now, they have improved the decalage angles on the newer planes. They tend to still have some divergence in decalage. You know, 1 degree is not an issue, but it's like, you know, 2, 3, 4 degrees, then you may want to change the tail. I think they've changed this tail design too to make it a little more difficult to actually change the decalage, but a lot of times you can do that just by bending the fuselage and changing that decalage angle. So you just got to check your kit. There's more of a problem with the fuselages being bent right and left more than a decalage issue. So unless your elevator is really out of whack when you're flying along and it's, you know, 5 degrees up or 5 degrees down to fly the plane, then you may want to investigate changing the decalage. Otherwise, leave that for a last sort of bit of tuning. You want to do elevator setup, mechanical, and radio first, then start moving your CG and see where your trims end up. Now, I've discovered a major problem on this particular Radian, and I don't think they've really changed how they make the stabs. They may have improved this, but the skin can delam. You can see as I put a little upward pressure on the elevator, how the skin lifts up, and it's actually separated from the leading edge back. So when the skin delaminates, you're losing structural integrity because the skin glued to the foam gives rigidity to the stab here. So even if you have the clear tape on, like I have on this one, if that skin's pulled away from the foam, tape's not really doing any good. So I'm going to have to get some glue in there. You can use some thinned epoxy, maybe even some white glue. You don't want to use Gorilla Glue because it's going to expand and make, you know, bubbles and weird stuff here. Probably use some foam safe CA as well to fix that. But you really want to check that, because you have had people that try to fly these planes fast and they wonder why they go into a tuck or crash or get overspeeded and they can't pull out of a dive. It's, you know, it's pretty flexy back here, and it doesn't take much to overpower that servo in the front. And if there's any wobble or the hinge isn't lined up, when you push elevator, the elevator just moves, that hinge line moves up and down, but doesn't actually give you any deflection. So you can pretty easily run at an elevator at higher speeds, and that can cause a runaway speed event and a crash. Also found a delam right here, right at the stress point. You can see right there, so it pulls up. So I'm going to have to get in there with a knife, and you can slice it in the front here. Get some glue back in there, let it drip all the way down, and make sure you get that skin glued firmly back to the foam core. It's kind of like a molded airplane, similar construction. So once the skin lets go to the foam, you lose a lot of structural integrity. I've seen some of these spars pull away from the foam, and they're not doing any good if they're not glued firmly to the foam. So I re-glued this one, put tape over it, so it's pretty strong now. Now, of course, I'm going to fire up the radio and inspect the radio gear, make sure everything's working right. I'll look for loose wires on the receiver, any chafing, binding, broken wires, anything like that. Of course, we'll go up to the front here, check for any loose mounts. Just make sure the ESC is working correctly and all that stuff. We're not going to show that in this video, but we'll do a quick little test run. And of course, we'll make sure that our prop nuts and everything are fine in the spinner. Inspect our propeller as well. Make sure there's no cracks or big dings in it. And that's about it for the inspection. It looks pretty darn good for as many miles as this plane has. So let's dive in and now inspect the servo problem and get these fixed up right. Okay, so here's the servo setup. As it comes stock, even though I have moved the arm on the elevator from that hole at least the inward to that hole, but I can't go any farther because it's going to hit this servo here. The radians still come with this servo setup, which is absolutely backwards to the way you want to have your servos installed, because we really want these push rods driving from as far inboard on the servo arm as compared to where the axle center is. We want the, especially on the elevator, we want it to run on this hole or even further inside, because we want the servo to go through full travel to give us the most resolution and torque that we can get out of that servo. We want to set the radio so it has the maximum amount of throw, you know, over 100% if possible, and then have this mounted inboard. But you can see, to have this rod, without shortening it or lengthening it, we're going to have to move the servo all the way over here to be able to get this Z-bend into the, at least this hole, if not one that we're going to make further inboard, because we need to have this servo go through full travel to get the elevator to travel its full travel. This is really backwards. We're giving up a tremendous amount of resolution on the elevator system. The longer this arm is and this connection point, the more slop we're going to get. Also, the disadvantage of having the elevator weight on this arm here is we have to turn down the throws and the radio way down, because we're going to get too much throw, because we do get more throw as the connection goes further out the arm, but that's not what we want. That's the opposite of what we want. Plus, that surface has more leverage over the servo as well. So as the elevator forces translate through the rod here, it has more leverage over the servo gears here, and you'll get less torque out of the system. Now here's the rudder servo. I can only move it in one. If we try to move it in further, this is going to have to bend to get into the servo. And we're going to have asymmetric travel, and it just puts too much stress on the system, and we definitely may get double centering. Now the rudder is not as critical as far as resolution, because we want to get enough throw. But again, we're getting way too much throw out here. It's going beyond what, you know, the travel limits, mechanical travel limits of the rudder. So we have to dial down the volume or the endpoints in the radio, you know, to lessen the throw down, so the rudder is not being overdriven. Because with the servo moving 45 degrees either way, it's going to overdrive that rudder past its mechanical limitations. And that's an issue. Again, the rudder has a lot of power over the servo, having this lever arm so long. Now I'm going to move the elevator with my hand and put a little mechanical force on that push rod system. With a little bit of force, you can see things are moving. The Z bend is moving a little bit at the arm, but you can see the arm is moving a few degrees. Plus, you can see, it might be hard, the whole axle center, at the center of the screw here, this is also moving side to side. So between those three things, we're getting a double neutral situation where the servo never gets to go back to its program center point. Now let's do the same test with a rudder. Even though the rudder clevis is further inboard to the rudder blade, it's going to have a little bit less mechanical force on the servo. Let's go ahead and move that rudder back and forth. And you can see we have a tremendous amount of slop. Now the Z-bend here is nice and tight, but the servo arm is moving back and forth, plus the bearing here is completely gone. So there's slop of the whole axle moving back and forth and right to left and fore and aft. As you can see here, I can see it totally moving. The servo itself is not moving because it's pretty securely glued in, so the whole axle is moving. So this servo is pretty much shot, and this one is in pretty bad shape too. So we're getting double centering on both surfaces. So how do we solve this problem? Well, the first thing you can do, you know, if you have a new radian, is we need to move these servos, because really this servo needs to be over here closer to the rod so we can run it on, say, the second hole or even this one for the rudder. So the servo needs to move over. This one opposite, it needs to be over here closer so this push rod can run straighter, but have it run to this inside hole, or even one further inside, like we do on DLGs, closer to that center axle, and drill our own hole to mount this clevis here. So, you know, if you have a stock setup, these servos are going to last for a while, but remember, these are inexpensive servos, they're not digital, so the centering is not going to be great anyway. Run it like this, and you're just putting slop in the system and losing a ton of resolution for a servo that doesn't have much resolution to begin with. So what we're going to do is we're going to disconnect the radio. We're going to pull the receiver back out of the way. We're going to pull the wires for the flaperons back through, clean everything up. We're going to take the servo arms off, disconnect them from the rods. And then we're going to slice. There's just white silicone. I think I have some, looks like some extra silicone that I put in here or something, some sort of squishy glue to keep the servos really tight in there. We're going to need to slice down with a razor knife and pull the servos out. And then we'll see if we can find a position to put the servos back in. I'll show you how to do that. Realistically, I think I'm going to replace both of these servos with some digitals or at least some higher quality analogs, because these are basically worn out. I'm not going to put these back in the airplane. They're definitely doomed to fail, and they have a lot of slop too. To get these out, you just need to put a razor knife of some sort and just slice down side of the servo, because all the glue is on the side and there's really not much on the bottom, I've found. And just slice down through, clean it up, and you usually pull right out. So pretty easy. You see there's not a whole lot of silicone holding these in. So here's what the bay looks like after the servos have been removed. This big hole right here is where I had the leads for the flaperons. If you don't have flaperons, don't worry about the hole. Just gonna have a big piece of foam that's still there, but I'm gonna probably have to put another hole here to leave those flaperon extensions. Now I taped the elevator and the rudder in the zero position with some masking tape, and then I've marked the zero position of the Z bend right here. So that's where the center of the rudder servo is gonna go. I also did the same thing for the elevator as well. So that's the zero point. That'll give me a good reference when I'm actually putting the servos back in. I'll line up the servo axles with that line, and I'll know that's going to be my mechanical dead center. Now my basic strategy is I want to move the servo over in the bay. I want to have the rudder drive instead of from way out here. I'm going to have it run either from the second or furthest hole in, just like I would do on any standard glider. We're going to get plenty of throw having the rudder drive from any of these two holes if the servo is programmed to go through its full electronic travel. Now what we're going to do is move the rudder servo. Instead of driving from way over in this position, we're just going to merely move it over. We're going to drive the rudder from the second hole or the furthest hole in on the arm. We're going to cut the rest of this arm off, because as long as we have the servo going through its, you know, full electronic travel and we're not binding up in the back mechanically, we should be able to move the servo over, have the push rod lead right into that second hole, and have just enough clearance so that arm just kisses the foam, or we can dig that foam out just a little bit. So we get the servo over as far as we can, get it in the hole we want, and then mount it back in. Now you can see the servo roughed into a new hole here. Just took a little bit of foam out in the back here. You can see the push rod now comes in clean in a straight line and doesn't have to bend, and it's not under any stress or tension right or left, fore and aft. This is where the servo should be, right into the second hole. You know, it's got plenty of clearance here still, even with the servo straight up and down, to clear the side of the fuselage here. So that's what a proper servo install should look like. Now I've got to figure out how to fill the gaps here, and then we're going to rough in the elevator servo and figure out how to fill these gaps and to secure the servos tight enough so they don't move during flight. Now it was a little bit of work getting the silicone off the servos here. You want to remove that because it's just going to be a mold release for whatever type of glue you use to glue these in. I just used my Dremel sander and sanded it off, and it roughed up the plastic, and it'll help whatever kind of glue I use to stick a little bit better to the servo case. So I'm not keeping these. I really don't care how they look. These are going in the trash anyway. So here's the elevator servo prepped. You can see I've shortened the arm quite a bit down to that last hole, rounded off the ends here. If you're flying a lot of acro or things like that, you may want to go for a second hole, or maybe even leave the third if you really need that much throw. But it doesn't take a lot of servo rotation to get that elevator to go 45 degrees or so anyway. So sailplane guys, we want the resolution, not care as much about total throw. So I'm going to use that inside hole here, and I could probably go even further in on the servo if I wanted to really maximize that elevator feel. Now there are two ways you can mount the elevator servo. If you want to use the existing bend, you're going to have to line the axle, remove some more foam up here, and mount the servo add a corner to the rudder servo like that, and then line everything up. Now I think a better strategy is to mount the servo side by side. I still need to carve out a little piece of foam down in there, but I can get these mounted in side by side like that. And then I'm going to have to cut the wire and make a new Z-bend, but that's super easy to do. Or you could put a clevis on there if you want some adjustability. But I think I can get these lined up. That way when I glue them in, they provide some structural strength across this way. And it'll keep the fuselage a little bit stiffer than having to remove some more foam. So I think I'm going to use that strategy. Cut some of that foam out so I can get the servos to match in. And then I'm going to cut and do a new Z-bend. Now I'm going to replace these two servos, but I think I can just drop in, you know, the ones I'm thinking about using are pretty much the same size, so I can just drop them in. So I'm not worried about cutting this push rod. Plus I've got some spares anyway if I mess it up. Just get these aligned and make sure that your fins in the back are taped to their zero mechanical centers before you cut this. You get one chance at it. You want to make sure the downward part of that Z-bend, make sure the servo is at 90 degrees, and it lines in, make sure that Z-bend goes right down the center there, because you don't have much mechanical adjustability and you want to make sure everything's dead center. And you might have to use a little bit of sub-trim, but that's no big deal. Now once I have the servos exactly where I want them to be, probably a good idea to glue them in first, but I can take a rough guess here. I'm going to line up my needle nose pliers right at the forward edge of the hole, because remember the bend's going to take up a little bit of distance too. Line it up, and I'm going to do a bend right there for my new Z-bend. I hit our servos with a new Z-bend in place. I made sure that the stab is taped in the zero position back there. And I did use a servo tester, like this one, to set the servo at its electronic dead center. Set the horn on, screwed it down, and then I cut my Z-bend to match that, so I know everything's now dead center. I did a soft Z-bend, so it puts a little bit of tension in the hole, so it gets rid of any slop. If you have slop, your holes are a little too big for the wire, use a little drop of CA in there, and then it'll take out any remaining slop, as it creates a little bit of a bearing in there, fills up that hole, and that works really well for removing remaining slop. Now the final step is to figure out how to glue these in. Maybe use some hot glue, maybe some 5-minute epoxy. Just want to get these lined up, get them glued together. They'll add a lot of strength, and then glue them to the foam. May even put a little piece of plywood across the tabs here that'll join this side of the fuse to that side of the fuse and tie the servos to the foam. I think that'd be a good strategy here. But this is really how these servos should be mounted in this airplane from the factory. I don't know why they do it this way. This is pretty standard sailplane stuff, or pretty standard any RC airplane stuff. This is our rudder. I think we'll have plenty enough throw as long as we have the volumes turned up on the radio. And here's our elevator servo, now optimized for resolution, and we'll still get plenty of throw in the back. Now we can fly our airplane at CGs. They're further back and still have a nice elevator feel. That's just critical for sailplanes. Now in reality, this still isn't the best place for the servos. They should have mounted them way up forward, like a standard sailplane up in the nose, or in the tail, so they're really close to the tail. Because I'd like to have the battery pack be right here near the CG, because the CG is right about here, and have a battery pack bay that allow you to have different size battery packs from, say, a 1,000 pack up to, say, a 2,200 pack, which would easily fit in here. And it wouldn't change the CG, so you can adjust your wing loading by the size of battery pack you have, and that'd be really cool. But with the servos here, the radio and the gear, it's just not set up correctly. I'd much rather have the battery in the center. Now, just as an example, I'm holding the servos down. I haven't glued them in yet, but I'm going to move the rudder mechanically in the back here, and it's remarkably stiffer already just by moving it in side a couple of holes. It's still rocking a bit at that the bearing top of the case and a little bit right there at the arm, but it's a much stiffer system now, and we're still going to get the same amount of throw ultimately in the end. Now let's take a look at the elevator. I'm going to jiggle that with my hand. Absolutely rock solid now. It's not moving at all. Even putting a lot of force on it, the plastic back there just bends, but does not want to force that push rod forward anymore. And even a lot of the rock is now out of that bearing case. So already a huge improvement. plane's going to fly the same, we're going to get the same amount of throws. As long as we go in the radio and turn our endpoints or volume adjustment for throw higher up. Now the whole reason to change the servo geometry around is to gain resolution of the mechanical system and the servos, and not necessarily to get a maximum amount of throw. Especially as we get that CG back, we don't need the elevator to move all that much. And rudder, you can set the tune as you feel necessary for good turning. So let's take a look at my endpoints on my JR9503 here. And you can see I have the elevator set for 88 down, 95 up. But remember, this radio can do 150%, and that's so you can get, you know, if the servo can do it, it can go through the entire electronic pulse width that's available for RC systems. And I've got the rudder set at 100/100. Now, if I was actually flying the airplane with these settings, even though they're not close to maximum, I would be locking out both the elevator and the rudder mechanically. They'd be going against the mechanical stops before they went through the full, you know, 88/95 or 100/100 throw. So how do I have my radio set up, and what's really going on with my true endpoints? Now, even though the Radian is a pretty simple soaring machine, I added the flaperons and I wanted to fly more like my high performance sailplanes as far as radio setup. So I have flight conditions set up. I have a cruise, I have a thermal, and I have a reflex speed setting. I also have a launch mode as well. And the way I have the servo throw reduced is through the dual rate screen, as you can see here. So let's scroll through a few of these here. So position one is actually my cruise, but you can see I have 50% dual rate comes in when I'm in cruise. So even though my endpoints were set close to 100, I'm actually only getting 50% throw on the elevator. Otherwise, it'd be hitting the mechanical stops with those super long servo arms. So when I change the servo arms shorter, I'm going to be either eliminating the dual rates or setting this up to at least 100, 125. And when I go to different flight modes like thermal, let's go to thermal here, which is position zero, which is up here 60%, so I have a little bit more elevator throw available because I'm flying slower. And then speed reflex has a little bit less elevator than that. And that's kind of my speed reflexes for acro, so I want to have a little bit, you know, extra elevator for doing loops and things like that. Use just smallest amounts of expo. That's because of the long arms. Once I get the servo set up correctly, I can pump up the dual rates here, and I can get rid of the expo, because expo is really not the way to reduce the feel. If you have too much of any surface, like the elevator or rudder, you don't want to use expo to try to make that plane flyable. That's really the wrong thing to do. And that's why we're changing things mechanically on the servos first, and then the radio program, and then we can get the plane to fly correctly. Now, most modern radios have a servo monitor screen. We show you the position of the servo as far as the trims, but also shows you how much volume you're getting when you actually move the stick. So let's look at the elevator, which is second from the bottom on the left. Let's see how much throw we're actually getting. So there's up stick. You can see it's really not moving all that much. The end of the bar is 150%. So there's my down. So you can see I'm getting less than half of the actual volume available for that servo to move the elevator. So the servo monitor screen is very useful for seeing how much throw you're actually getting for those different flight modes. If I change the flight mode, I would see the volumes change. And let's take a look at the, see if we can see it change with my flight modes. You can see the cursor on the elevator jumping around as I change the flight modes. Because of the dual rates coming into function, I get less or more throw. So once we change the servos, we'll be able to use the monitor to see how much we're getting, because I want to see the elevator go almost all the way out to the end of the bar for up and down. That means we're getting the most resolution out of the servo. So here's the finished install with the new servos. For the rudder, I used an older high-tech, this is the HS85BB, which is a really good older analog servo, and it's perfect for the rudder. You can see the horn shortened down quite a bit. I have several holes to choose from, but I can adjust that travel. You can see the rudder's going through full travel. left and right. So I'm getting about 35 to 45 degrees of rudder in the back, and I can adjust the throw either by moving this further out, further in, or adjusting it at the horn itself. Here's the elevator servo, and I'm using a Airtronics 94761. This is a digital high torque. In fact, the servo is worth probably three or four times what the entire airplane is worth. But it was the only mini digital that I had in stock, and it is a spare for another plane. So when I install these, I use screws and a little bit of glue between them, but I can take the servo out and replace it with something more reasonably priced. See, I put the plywood pieces across and hot glued the whole thing in. And now it's really stiff because now the servos are actually a structural member and are tied into the walls of the fuse on the side. So this part of the fuse is really, really stiff with the cross pieces in here. And again, I can just pop the servo right out. So let's take a look at the elevator throw. You can see it's going nearly 45 degrees up and down. And that's what I want. I have the endpoint adjustments turned up, and we'll see the radio set up in a minute here. But this plane's ready to fly, and everything's absolutely tight. There is zero slop in this system. In fact, I can go in the back here, and I can yank down on the elevator flap here. Nothing moves. It's as stiff as one of my carbon planes, and same with the rudder. And it's really, really nice and tight, and that's the way I want it. So now when I fly, I'm going to have no neutral, double neutral centering in the elevator system at all. Now here's a close-up of the elevator clevis, and I have it at the very last hole of the horn to get the best mechanical advantage and most resolution out of the servo. If I really needed more throw, I could move it in one or two holes, but I really wouldn't go any farther than that. Now as far as throw, here's my full up, full down. That's all I'm getting, and that's all I need. With the CG aft, it's going to be very pitch sensitive, not unflyable, because you can see how it centers perfectly now. And it's not going to be unflyable. That's all I really need. If I find I need to have a little bit more throw mechanically, I can just move the clevis up one or two holes closer to the surface, and I'll get a little bit more throw out of it. So here's a detail of the rudder horn. I haven't moved in two holes because even with the endpoint adjustments turned up and the servo going through its full travel, I needed to get a little bit more throw out of the rudder. Since I'm flying with the flaperons, the aileron function is doing a lot of the turning, so I don't need to have a whole lot of throw. I've got about 35 to 40 degrees of throw, and that's fine. But even though I ran it in a couple holes inside, it's still super stiff, and the rudder doesn't have any mechanical advantage over the servo anymore. And everything's much tighter, and the rudder centers more accurately now as well. Okay, now let's look at our new endpoints. Here's for the elevator. And remember, we had before just below 100. Now up, we got 134, down 98. These are offset because there are some mechanical throw limits to the system. But I have it max, so 134 is the uppermost that elevator can travel, and 98 is the down elevator as far as it can really go. And I had to be careful with that big digital servo because I was actually bending the fuselage if I went beyond the mechanical limits for the elevator. So that's kind of our master here. And let's look at the rudder. Rudder is now boosted up to 120 and 124. These numbers are a little bit different because the travel on the rudder is a little asymmetrical. So the offset in the numbers evens that rudder throw out from left to right. Let's take a look at the dual rate screen now. So here's the dual rate screen for the elevator. And you can see things have changed quite drastically. So position one is my cruise. It's now 95%. Now with the endpoints, that kind of gives you a general endpoint for that servo. But the dual rate's going to actually override those basic endpoints. This is basically a percentage of the throw available in those first endpoints that I set. So for position one, I want to have a little bit less elevator than full max travel. Have that set at 95%, so I'm getting just a little bit less than what the endpoint screen was showing that we just reset. Let's go to position zero, which is thermal. And I want a full amount of throw, planes flying a lot slower, and I have that set at 100%. So it's getting 100% of that throw set in the end points. And same position two, reflex acro. Need a little bit less elevator because the plane's flying much faster, so it's set at 84% of that endpoint throw. And we got 10% expo, just to add a little bit of deadness right around center. Now, expo does two things. You can either add throw around stick center, subtract throw around stick center, or you can use expo to actually make the servo input a little bit more linear, actually. But I tend not to like to use expos. If you set the resolution properly with the servos and the mechanical setup, usually expo is not required. So the elevator dual rates are kind of the same. Let's go to rudder. You can see I've got position 196, kind of like the elevator, position 0, 100, position 2, which is the fastest, less throw available, and all linear here. Now you can use dual rates to actually override those endpoints. So we have 100% of the servo travel in our endpoints. Our endpoints were set to the mechanical limits. If we boost up the dual rates for, say, position zero, say 120%, we're going beyond those endpoints that we originally set for the servo. But remember, we set those endpoints to the mechanical limits, so at 120, we'll be overdriving the servo, probably bending the push rods, putting some stress on the system, stressing the servo, and like that. So keep that in mind when setting up dual rates and your endpoints. Let's take a look at the servo monitor really quick. Let's look at the elevator first. Here's up and here's down. Remember, before we were only going about 40% along that bar. Now we're going almost to the full end here. And you know, we do have some mechanical limitations as far as throw, but we're getting over double the resolution in our system. Same with rudder. Now we're getting almost to the end of the bar here, using 100% of our throws for most part, you know, depending on the flight mode. So much better. Things are moving farther down the bars, especially important with that elevator. We just have a ton more resolution. And you can see we took out slop. Centering's now perfect. We have much better feel on the stick without using expo because we've got more resolution out of that system. Well, I got the old flying beer cooler all ready for another flying season. We did a servo swap. We worked out the servo geometry on the push rods, got rid of that double neutral problem, retaped the tails, did a couple of other minor repairs. I even did some paint touch up on the wingtips and sanded off all that ugly yellowy epoxy on the fuselage. So, you know, this plane's looking pretty good, about as good as it did 7 or so years ago when I first put it together. So, if you found this video valuable to you, check out my other pay videos on my site, radiocarbonart.com, and go there and check out my 26 other how-to videos, which covered pretty much everything of RC soaring, from DLGs, thermaling techniques, a lot about plane building, prep and tuning, and things like that. It's information you're not gonna find for free on YouTube, and you're not gonna find this stuff on the forums. I make these videos very in-depth and high quality, even higher quality than this video. And you know, support the work that I do. So use that coupon code too. It's Radian15. It'll take 15% off any DVD or digital download on my site. So check my videos out. I also have a lot of good free stuff on the YouTube channel you can watch for free, including my Hobie Hawk series. So anyway, I like to fly this thing today, but it's snowing outside still, so it's gonna be another week or two before the weather's good to fly this whole thing. But doing the servo swap's really gonna improve the pitch feel on this airplane, and it's gonna make this plane fly even better than it did before. It flies remarkably good for a big chunk of foam.